Hola, peoples.
Hola.
Okay, well, I think I posted everywhere that we're going live. You know, DWT, Deviant Witchery Time. You already know what that means. That means, you know, 5, 10, 15 minutes after our scheduled time. It happens. Shit happens. Things happen.
Love happens.
Shut up. but... So tonight, I really do feel like there's something off, and I can't place it, and that's really bothering me. Anyways, tonight we're our show. That's one thing. We're Nuts and Bolts Witchery, our series. We talk about tools and different things like that. Tonight we're talking about crafting your own spells and crafting formulas. So, if the Q&A is up, if there's anything that you'd like to ask, anything that you'd like to participate in, utilize the Q&A. Again, we're talking about, because I see people coming in, we're talking about crafting spells and crafting formulas. Any questions on anything pertaining to that, feel free to use the Q&A. I had to repeat myself, I'm sorry, because every time I see, like, more people join, just like now, there's more people joining, I like to make sure that everyone understands the whole process. And that is Nuts and Bolts Witchery, one of our series that we're doing. This is the third time. we're going to have fun, y'all. We're going to have fun. We're going to talk about our process and how to craft our own spells, what we do, and all the different things that you can take into consideration. Maybe even essential oils, herbs, crystals, different things that go into creating formulas and spells. So, Melissa, this was kind of your thought process and one that you participated in creating. So tell us a little more about what was going through that mind of yours when you decided, like, we kind of co-created this, but what were you thinking?
Well, I was thinking, Michael and I both had been discussing what we should do for Nuts and Bolts Witchery, and I thought it would be a good idea to talk about our process, you know, how we get into that zone of creation, what we do, how we create, what inspires us, things like that, because, you know, honestly, you have books of spells, and they'll just tell you all about the spells, and you have books on witchcraft and different aspects of witchcraft, but I don't recall ever reading anything that really talks about how people create, besides just giving you basic information with this is how you should do it, and these are the words you should say, and you should do it when the moon is full, or whatever.
Right.
I don't know. I thought it'd be fun to discuss our process, how
right.
we go about doing it.
And, you know, one of the biggest things, and well, I guess we can talk about crafting spells first. One of the biggest things in crafting your spell, of course, is going to be what do you need, you know? And this is how when I create a spell, there's a hair. It's going to bother me. Ugh. When I cast... and create my own. I kind of just make a list. I do a list. I write my topic. I write my, like, what I really want. And I just brainstorm. What do I really want? Like, I want this big thing, but, you know, I just go, I list it out. Like, how I'm going to get there. Everything that having this will make me feel. You know, what I feel when I have that, what will I experience, like how will I interact with the world around me when I get this. And listing all that out helps me prepare, like what day, if I use a specific day, it helps me prepare for like correspondences. And it helps me to prepare for like the different herbs and the oils and stuff that I use. But knowing that your main goal... and the different, like, the feelings attached to it and the, you know, the different things that you want from it helps you to put in what you need. And I hear my echo. I'm sorry.
Sorry. That might be me.
If you feel any better, it's not that bad. Oh, I hear myself, too.
Oh.
A little bit. Anyways, yes. Thoughts. I'm not as organized as you are, naturally. I am a very much an emotional caster. And I don't think very much into that process. The hardest thing for me is, like you said, is actually figuring out what I want. Because the first part of the initial process is figuring out exactly what you want, because I like to be very specific, which is not a skill or a thought that I originally had when I was a baby witch. So what do you guys think about that? Has it grown for you guys, the process
of being
very specific? Because me, yeah, you know, before I was like very broad, and I wasn't, and then the more I go, the more focused I am. So
I think that, you know, I think as a young practitioner, a lot of what we're taught is to not ask for specifics, and that's kind of like ingrained. When the first thing a lot of people come to is like love work, love spells, you can't ask for specific love. And so even though they're not saying you can't ask for that specific car, it kind of transfers, because they're saying in this working, in this cast, you can't ask for a specific thing. So then it transfers over to different beliefs where you can't ask for what you really, really, really want. You have to be broad, just because the universe might give you a yellow car instead of a white car. Oh, you really want a white car. I've noticed, like, yeah, it started out very vague, but then I was like, the fuck? Like, I don't care. Like, I want what I want. No one's going to tell me that I have to settle. Because in the long run, that's what it means. Like, as a witch, we have power. We're strong. We want what we want. And so you cast. You shouldn't have to settle in your casting. Now, granted, if you cast for something, and then there's those minor, you know, minor things that are off, but you're okay with that, and it comes to you, and it's offered to you, fucking take that shit if you want it. Because it's there. It's being gifted to you, and that might be a sign where, you know, you might have to alter something you said before, you know, in your working, or alter a different herb or something to get more of 100% of what you want. But I've noticed that I ask now for specifics, and I receive specifics.
Yeah, you know, for me, it was a little bit of both. I didn't realize that you could ask at first that specifics was a thing, a lot for the reasons that Michael suggested. But also, there was so much conflicting information. You know, one book would say use such and such herbs for this, and the other book would say, no, don't use those herbs, you should use these herbs, and vice versa. There was just a lot of conflicting information, so I was very hesitant, because I'm one of those people that I have to have, everything has to make sense and everything has to click, and I want to, like, you know, have it perfect, because I'm a perfectionist when it comes to things like that. And it took a lot of, once I finally decided, okay, I just need to just throw myself into this and do it, because just sitting here reading all this stuff is driving me crazy. It's not getting me anywhere. I'm not doing anything. So I just sort of dove in and said, fuck it. I'm going to just throw this shit together and hope for the best. You know?
I agree. I totally agree. Because
that's the way I started. I started, you know, writing down, like Michael said, specifics, and this is exactly what I want. And at first, I would, like, research like crazy, but now it's way more instinctual. It's way more, I've worked with this herb, so I know exactly what's going to happen if I mix it with this other herb, because, you know, I have experience with both. So it's different now, but at first, oh my gosh, I just throw shit together and be like, okay, let's see what happens.
I agree, and I'm not going to tell you that I still don't do that, because some of the best things that I've ever learned was because I just threw some shit together. And and I do need to specify this. When we're throwing shit together, it's way more involved than what we are actually. We're putting it very lightly when we're throwing shit together. It's not that we just do that, namby-pamby, whatever, who cares. It's not like that. It's very specific. And we draw from the knowledge that we have acquired over the years, and that accrued knowledge has become a very well-placed, ooh, look at that pretty, and that knowledge base that we learned from all those books that we read and all those experiences that we read about kind of comes into play when you're actually going for it. And then it comes in the spontaneity and the whimsy of spell casting that still happens, and I think is a very important part of it. Because if you're very, okay, this is what I need, there's no, I can't bend on this, I can't bend on that, there's no room for anything other than what I have in my head, then that's when you're your own worst enemy.
You have to, when you're creating and casting, it's challenging because you have to have that leeway, but you have to also be very firm and dominant in the sense that this is what I want. Like it's hard to express because like you need that dominating energy. You need to say this is what I want. This is what I'm gonna get. But at the same time, you have to be open enough to allow for alterations. Not saying that that's what you're casting for, but just depending on different situations, depending on how it's best received, depending on other things, you have to allow for the spirits, the gods, the universe to have their parts in creating for you, in bringing things to you.
Right. Well, a good example of that is I cast a spell a while back. I was working. Robert was having problems finding construction gigs that were steady. This is like not long after the housing market crash, so that was kind of a chancy, you know, job anyway. So I cast a spell for prosperity for, you know, for him specifically because I was doing really good in my job, but my job just wasn't, you know, producing enough money to support everybody in the style in which we were used to being supported, put it that way. So Robert was, you know, he had taken a walk. He's really down and depressed or whatever. And he just happened to stumble across a $100 bill. And I'm like, that's not what I wanted. What is that going to do? But that lasted until he got this really big job 3 days later and really helped us in ways that, you know, if he hadn't, it wouldn't have, you know, it would have been a lot worse for us. So it was kind of, it worked, but it didn't work in the exact way in which I thought it would because it started off with something way different. And then eventually it got there. But if it hadn't started out that way, we would have been in a lot worse shape. But right, I was totally right. Pissed off for a good 2 days. I was like, "That is $100 is not going to fix things." You know?
Well,
so you never know. It might not work out exactly. And if I hadn't have been so irritated, I would have appreciated it a lot more at the time, and who knows what would have happened in those other 2 days, 2 to 3 days before he got the job that, you know, we could have gotten even more.
I'm a firm believer that if, when money comes to you, just don't even ask any questions. Don't even, just accept it, say thank you, and then move on. But no, I tend to do that a lot, and I've actually grown as far as like prosperity, abundance, money, spell castings, and Michael can probably tell you, and probably you too, Melissa, at the difference in my headspace, how I look at those kind of workings now as opposed to in the past and how I looked at them, because I thought, well, prosperity, I want everyone in this house to be prosperous, so that's a goal, and then I want money to flow to me, and those spells are great. But see, the problem with that is money can flow to you. A penny is money. A $40,000 job is also money. And without that specification, when you're working those prosperity workings, that's where it gets a little hazy. Again, I accept all money into my life. I say that to myself every day. That's a fucking mantra that I've learned. I feel like fucking Michael with his... His wonderful, those have helped me a lot, by the way, Michael, because I'll see you post those very self-assurant, wonderful posts, and then I'm like, oh, I need to remind myself of that. But also, I'll do workings like that, but I will also do prosperity workings of the specific variety now. So I kind of double duty up on that. I want money to flow to me in whatever way the universe sees fit, and I want to attract it to me at all times, but also I'm working this spell, not getting in the way of this spell, but more specific and ongoing, and they're both active, both are fed, and both flow to me. And you can do it either way. You could do a specific thing and then it be the end-all be-all, or you could do this very broad thing and deal with that. But that's just how I do specific prosperity magics. I will be very specific, yet also work a broad magic as well.
Right. And you know, this is so... it doesn't matter what it is. They express, I have fucking a hair in my or something that's really bugging me. They say that, you know, magic and our craft and what we cast, it travels, you know, the path of least resistance, which, you know, is true. So when we give specifics and we direct our casting, it has that to flow with. It's not going to try looking for the least resistance. I mean, it is, but it's going to have those filters, so when you cast, it knows that it's going to avoid there, it's going to avoid there, it's going to avoid there, because you have specifics attached to it where it can see that line, that thread, the fabric that is going to be attached to your result. And so that's why it's so important to, yes, be open to receiving the abundance and everything that the cosmos, whatever, has to offer. But when you add your filter, when you add, just like on YouTube, you know, you have your filters. It dwindles down the relevance of your posts and stuff like you want to see. That's the same thing when we cast. It's like, okay, I'm going to have this filter, I'm going to have this filter, I'm going to have this filter. And then you start to fine-tune it, and it shoots out, and you're on your way. So it's very important to have, that has been said already, to have specifics and to be open to receiving what's in your highest and best, I guess. But
right. When creating formulas and spells, as it goes to actually creating that magic, do you guys think, this is a held belief of mine, and I don't know how you guys feel about it, because I don't think we've ever talked about it. I believe that my magic that I send forth is very similar to my, it's like a carbon copy of who I am. All magic has a fingerprint. Every person's magic is different. I am a person that will cut corners every fucking chance I get because I don't like the long way around. So I tend to believe that my magic will do whatever the fuck it can to get to the target. Not fuck everything that's going after it this way. It's like, this is the easy way. This is the way I'm going to do it. And that is my personality. Do you guys think that it's different based on the witch when it comes to that? It
was I do. You know, because like,
yeah,
I totally see your magic doing that, because that is very you.
Yeah.
Where I feel like my magic is more passive aggressive. Because that's more me.
Yeah.
You know, it gets where it's going, but again, it's going to do it without causing too much chaos. Does that make sense? You know, it would definitely, I feel like my magic would more go with the flow and follow the path of least resistance than, say, your magic would if we were casting the same spell. So I might have to wait a little longer for my results than you would yours. Just because I feel like that, like you said, it takes on the persona of the person.
You're very much go with the flow. You're very much... You know, you're focused, but you have patience in that way. There's some things you don't have patience for.
No, but that's no thanks, not at all.
But where mine, I'm more like a bull in a china shop. And that is very much, I think, the essence of my magic. It's like, you know, again, my finesse is not as greater than you two, because you two have your magic is very fine and very fine-tuned, where mine is like, go after it, go after it, go after it. You guys is like, okay, we're going to go after it, but we're going to be easy peasy going that way. And then Michael's like, we're going to go after it, but we're going to be a bitch the entire time, and we're going to fuck as much shit up as we can to get to that. No, that's not true. But it is, he's very fine-tuned. So I think that Michael thinks so broadly that his magic is different than mine, where I focus just on the goal. Michael sees everything in its path and has a way to work a spell to make sure that everything in that path has been handled, to where you, Melissa, you'll weigh. You'll be like, okay, well, if it has to hit that wall, that's okay. It will come. It's okay. It will come. And that's very interesting.
Well, and it's important, you know, there are so many things that are important in crafting a spell and a formula, but it's important to know your personal essence. And before we go into this, randomness magic commented, we will get to your comment for sure. I don't think we're ignoring you. We will definitely address that. But it's so important to know the witch, to know yourself, and to know how your personality and your personal magic, your personal power, interacts with, you know, the outside world, interacts with the astral realms, and how it's expressed. Because when you take that into consideration, there are things that you want to avoid, and there are things that you want to utilize to enhance that. Like for, you know, for Hunter and I, again, not patience. You know, we want results, and we want it now. Same thing with Melissa. She wants results. She wants it now. But she's more like, we'll get there. You know, on most things, not all things. Again, like was said. But you know, we want our results. We want it like 5 days ago. We're not down with this waiting bullshit. I don't care who you are. Just fuck off, and we're getting our shit done. We want it. And so there, we wouldn't be utilizing things that are going to slow us down. We wouldn't be utilizing things that are going to be like, oh, well, I will get there, but I'm going to learn a lesson here. You know, might pick up a little, you know, a hippie on the side of the road. You know, we're going to have a little adventure. No, honey, the adventure is getting what we want.
We can go on those adventures, but after.
Exactly, after we get what we want. And so, yeah, so when you know that that's how your energy is, you don't want to start utilizing things that are going to prevent you from fulfilling that. You don't need to work with slower-acting herbs, slower-acting oils, or slower-acting crystals, things that are going to take time to process. On the other hand, if you're, you know, more kind of like Melissa's energy, and you go with the flow in a sense, which is not our fun expression, but you kind of take the time to go and get your stuff done and, you know, get sidetracked maybe, but all that sidetrack energy is getting you to where you need to be. You know, right. There are little mini adventures, mini, mini things that will help you along the way to get where you need to be. It's almost like forming small relationships, and these people add to your experience to get you the end result. So when you're that energy, then you do want to use things that are going to be a little slower and promote that growth spurt. You do not want to use things that are going to, like, force you to get, you know, at the end result right then, because it'd be pushing you and be forcing you to get somewhere, and you probably wouldn't get your results because you don't know how to process like that. It's not how you cast. It's not how your energy is working. And so you miss the little things that add up to receiving the bigger result.
And ingredients do not necessarily mean, fast ingredients don't necessarily mean powerful, as powerful. And slow ingredients don't necessarily mean less powerful.
Right.
Personally, right. It just, you have to know what works for you. And we have always said on that, we don't like substitutions. We don't like shit like that. That's why we're, to talk about formulations of formularies and spells is all hard for each of us because we don't do it in a very bookish, like, read it, do it, achieve it. We do it in our very own ways, and we know that, and therefore it's kind of hard to say, well, you need to use rose, and you need to use rose, and always use rose for love workings, because I've very few times use rose in love workings. So it's just horny goat weed is fantastic. But yeah, we are, are ingredients that we just know them well, and we use them to what suits our sales and our goals. So this is not going to be one of those shows that goes, use cayenne pepper in your, you know, hot foot powder because it does this. That's not one of them shows. You know, this is a.
Right. Well, you know, we each have our own experiences with different herbs, you know, and it's like, especially, you know, once we get our herbs from different areas. I grow a lot of mine, you know, where Michael and Hunter will order theirs from Mountain Rose Herbs or other places that they trust. So that plays a big difference too, because my rosemary isn't like the rosemary they use, because my rosemary is grown by myself and it's completely different. So, and obviously, oh yeah, there's some of my rosemary. And obviously it's not, you know, completely different, but it's going to have a
different, though. It is different.
You know, it's going to have a different energy to it because I put myself into it.
Exactly.
So all these ingredients, they're just completely different, and we're going to have different experiences with them. So as much as we would love to be like, you only use this for this, it's just not.
Well, and that's kind of like what we were saying just prior, like your own personal essence and how you cast and how it interacts with the world within and the world without. That is vital to understanding how you connect with the herbs and the oils and the different things that you utilize to cast and the different days too, because how we each process energy, it's going to be, again, filtered differently. So how we perceive, I think everyone perceives this the same way, but horny goat weed, that's what I had right here. So horny goat weed, I can't say it, but how we each perceive that is going to be determined by our filters, by how we experience our craft and what we need, and again, where we receive it. Everything sounds so long. When casting, again, let's just go back a little. You need your desire or your need. You know, you don't have to cast for just needs or necessity. You cast for desires, wants, whatever the fuck you want and you want to bring into your life. So you need that. And you need that passion for it. You need that, like, that lust for it. And then you decide, and not everyone utilizes the influences of the moon or the days, most likely. It's up to you to decide how bad you want it. And if you want it really bad, then you're not going to wait. So you will try to get as much correspondence in, that, you know, influence in as you can. But if you still want it badly, but you can wait, then you can wait for the perfect moon phase and the day, the hour, you know, astrological influence. That's for sure. You know, utilize that, but it's not necessary to do. You don't have to have everything aligned, because chances are you'll not have that.
Well, plus you can always use, like, if you're wanting to bring something to you, but we're in the waning phase of the moon, you can word things and use ingredients instead of bringing it to you, clear shit out of the way so it can come to you faster. You know? Right. So you can manipulate those things if you really feel the need. Now, sometimes, you know, it's challenging and you don't want to fuck with all that. So you just do it, you know. You know, in that case, I will, even if things aren't just aligned perfectly, if I really have to have it, if it's an emergency, then I'll cast regardless and add to it things that I know will push it more. Like, I'll throw in some, you know, I'll use a clear quartz to amplify what I'm doing. Throw in some dragon's blood because that's going to give it that extra oomph and push. You know, I know I love dragon's blood.
Dragon's blood.
So it's, you know, you can change things. You can work it around whatever you need. You just have to think, you know, creatively, I guess is the word I'm looking for, to get what you want, regardless of what time of day, whatever it is.
Exactly. Well, so what do you guys think? I mean, I have my definition. Both of you have yours. But just for, like, viewers' sake, what is the blueprint of a spell? What are the steps?
Fuck. Because any of you watch the MacGyver witchcraft video, that's kind of what I do. That's my steps. Like, the first thing, of course, is what the fuck do I want? Like, what am I passionate about? What is necessary for me to cast right now? What am I trying to achieve? Well, okay, take that. All right. And then I listen to spirit, I listen to my intuition, I listen to instinct. It just depends. Sometimes, like, okay, well, this is going to be a simple jar spell, you know? Okay, recently I did a love working, and it's not like a love working where I'm seeking someone to love me. It was actually a blessing where I have people who I love, who I placed in, shut up, you know, people, yes, these bitches right here, and some other bitches, but no, I utilized their energy, and I created something in their families, and I placed them in a jar. I'm like, I need a jar. This is a jar spell. I know that. And so I place them in a jar. I'm like, what do I need? I need something that's going to represent them. Okay. I have, like, paper. Like, I have wood stick figures, which I already blessed and anointed with, and they were named after them and all that shit. Okay, I have that. They were placed together with their, you know, husband, wife, blah, blah, blah. Okay. All right. Well, you know what? This is a love working. This is a lot, you know, I want to place it in a jar, so I'm going to utilize, do I have it with me? I do. Some red yarn, because red yarn was, like, right there. I'm like, okay, I'm going to do that, and I'm going to make sure to kind of, like, tie people together, because that's kind of what I want to create, like, a close-knit bond. I want everyone to feel comfortable, and, you know, yarn, it's kind of comfortable, but it gives that cozy feeling, and that's important for the working that I was doing. And then I'm like, you know what, I'm a witch, and what's sacred to witches? Apples. Apples represent wisdom, they represent love, they represent power, but they also represent lust and seduction. And that's just the nature of the witch, that's the nature of relationships. You need to be wise, and apples in the seeds offer a toxic essence as well, and love can be very dangerous. And it's important for everyone, you know, in that experience to understand that. And so I added apples to my jar, okay? There's a lot of other things that I added, and of course, liquid. There's vodka in there for sure. I know there's vodka in there. That's kind of how I process. Like, I decide what I need, and then I listen. And the type of spell, just the complexity. I am rambling, I'm sorry. But the variety of spell, it just, oh, my phone. Whoops. I thought I put on mute. It just depends. Okay, it's a jar spell. What am I going to put in that jar? And it's going to be essence of what I desire. And again, I love... love. Therefore, you know, apples, I'm looking at it right now, apples, red stuff, cinnamon, cayenne, a little bit of cayenne, just because I love spice. But I'll mix cayenne and chili powder. And a little bit of brown sugar. And I put that in there, and it just expresses what I want. So mine is very... chaotic. The way I process stuff, very chaotic.
I noticed that you've added things in that working, because and again, this is very important, but all of your ingredients get better with time.
Yes.
So Because, see, obviously the sugar, all of those things that last a while. But see, what people don't understand about apples is most people think, oh, apples rot. Well, apples ferment. And the fermentation process of the apples mixed with that alcohol becomes a very long-lasting product to work with. You would not use, and we actually had a comment, it's been a couple years back in the group. Yeah, it's been that long, about using, like, meat poppets. And, like, those are things you wouldn't use. You wouldn't want to use that for a love working, because those things decay and they rot and they don't get better with time. So that's just another added one of those. I just wanted to comment because that's an added thing that I know that we have probably always utilized in that time period and that thought process that people might not think of. So I thought that was you.
Well, yeah, I did. And for those, not like it's anyone's business, but I took a blessing that I already had done, and then I took that and transformed it into what it is now. Right. And I did, you're right, I did add the different ingredients and intensify it, and they do get better because you can take certain spells and transform them into something better and alter them like that. And there is a little bit of apple cider vinegar in there for specific purposes. And then I put, you know, I'm like, what do I want? I don't want a red candle because we don't want a red candle. Maybe we do. Well, that's not the type of spell that we're doing. maybe later. No, but I had a pink candle. There was a pink candle, and the pink represented exactly what I wanted because for me, when I was creating this jar, pink expressed its need to be on top. And so pink was like, I have passion, but my passion is for love. My passion is for the heart. My passion is for unconditional acceptance and connection. And pink, and if y'all hear screaming, that's my demons back in there. Crazy. But the pink was just like, I need to be present because I am the binding agent for everything that is stored within. And that's my chaotic, long fucking process, y'all.
But that's an awesome process. You know, for me, it depends on what I want to accomplish. If it's something really that I'm going to do quickly, it's a lot more chaotic. But if it's something that I have time to really think about and create, then mine is more organized. Only because that's the person that I am.
You're kidding.
So I will, figure out what I want to do, write that down, and then I will take out anything that I feel like will help me accomplish that. You know, I'll go to my little cupboard and just pull out all kinds of stuff. That I know will help in one way or the other. And I set them out, and then basically if it's something that really pulls to me, then I'll put it to the side. But if a lot of times I really just communicate with the essence of the herbs, the oils, whatever. And once I have them narrowed down, if there's anything that I feel doesn't quite fit, I'll do more research type work. Even though I have experience with this herb, if there's a reason why I feel like it's off and it won't interact well and I can't put my finger on it, if I can't find it in any books I have, then I'm going to ask these two. Like, why isn't this feeling right? Or what, y'all give me your impression of this herb or this oil or whatever. So right. I'm going to go to a resource that I trust, whether it be these guys or a book or a website or whatever. And then I start to create. And for me, it's kind of like a dance, and not just involving two people, but also involving the other dancers on the floor and the music too. I want everything to be very harmonious and to really flow. For me, it's a real visual kind of thing. Because I'll see these energies coming out from these herbs and oils, and the ones that look like they're flowing the best together, I'll use more of those than I would one that's kind of, you know, agitated and flitting around and being kind of crazy. So I won't use as much of that. And it's just, it's very instinctual for me once I get to that point, because I've done the research. And I'll play around with it. Sometimes it's not always perfect the first go around, which is annoying, because I'm like, oh, look at all this shit I just wasted.
Right.
But that's why I start out small. I've learned my lesson. I used to, like, start out pretty large, and then I'm like, wow, I just used up half my crap. It's not right. I don't like it.
That's small.
And once I figure out with a small amount, then usually I just feel it. I know it's about to work, so I'll start adding more once I know it's right.
Right.
And I'll have those ingredients, and I'll cast my spell. And I'm not one of those people that does, like, the one-day spell. If I'm doing, like, a one-day, I'm just going to cast, and that's it. It's usually because it's either something small or something that I need right now. But mine usually lasts quite a while. There's something that will, like Michael said, they'll sit and build energy and just get better with age. Not something that's just one day and done. I like things to build up.
Yours sounds so lovely next to mine. Because I'm very, very much different. I do not do long-going spells. Not that I don't. And for love, for example, love is one of those things that I take my time with, and I work it properly, and it lasts a while. And it's a long-going process, and it builds energy, and it's wonderful. Love is almost the only thing that I do that with. I love that Melissa described hers as a dance, because I would describe mine as sexual in nature. That is where a lot of my power comes from. I'm very solar plexus, very meet me at the Sabbat for a good time. Yeah, like very, that's my energy, and it doesn't. So spells to me are very sexual in nature. Not that I don't, because I do. I use sex magic, but it's not necessarily sex magic. Not that as a way, but from beginning to end, horny goat weed. From beginning to end, it is like it is a sexual experience. I will start out with this is prior to foreplay. My flirting with the energy is normally my research process, and that is a lot of times going to Melissa and Michael and saying, listen, I don't know fucking jack shit about crystals, and I need to know what crystals you would use in this situation. And then from that I go with what I would do and what crystals I have, what crystals I've utilized before, what feels right. So and it doesn't have to be crystals, it can be herbs, it can be any fucking thing in the world. Then the magic starts to process once I have that, and that's very much foreplay, and that's very much building up that energy. And then the deed begins, and it is very much a raise of energy, and it is the utilization of all those spirits and all those things that are around me and all of my guides and spirits, and it's a whole fucking, it's an orgy, and we're all building up our energy, and we're going through it, and we're raising it to a very high level. And then at the right time, it catalyzes and it climaxes, and then the build down process begins once the energy is released. And then not only that, but I have to come down from that energy. I have to, everybody else has to come down from that energy, and then I flow through it, and then I know instinctually if I had a good time or maybe I should try again tomorrow. that's my process.
Well, and it's important, you know, you express it as sexual in nature and very sensual for me. It's very important because, and there are very few well-written articles on the subject, but there are some good ones. Witchcraft in our practice is sensual, it is sexual. There is no denying it, and that's important to express it in the formulation process as well, because it can be very, very sensual, it can be very sexual, and it activates that energy because it's movement. And when we move, we raise desire, we raise essence, and when we connect with our witch self, when we connect with other witches, and especially if we enter the Sabbat, we experience that. And if you don't know that, it can be very traumatic, depending on the experience that you've had in your personal life. And sometimes people interpret it as a negative, when in truth it's not a negative. It's very liberating. But you really, it's something that needs to be talked about more, because, again, it's very sensual and sexual. And when you work with energy and you start to cast and you start to even, like, just plan, you will start to get different feelings, different, you know, chakras will, like, activate or, you know, flare up, and you'll start feeling certain ways. And our feelings and that energy that's moving through us, that activates memory, that activates, like, past experiences. And if we're not told about this and it happens, we can freak out. It can make us feel like shameful, dirty, negative. And that works against us. That is a negative towards our casting. So, yes, it can be very, again, like we said, sensual, sexual, all of that. And it's okay. It's not an unhealthy response. It's energy that you need to channel and move with and listen to. What is being expressed? What is necessary? Where is it taking you? Is it pushing you to a certain item? Is it pushing you to a certain, you know, anything? But in that moment, when that energy rises, don't feel negative about it. Enter it. And what I tell, and this is what you can do as well, what I tell a lot of my clients when I say we do healing work, breathe into that space. So you'll breathe into that experience. So if you have energy moving through any part of your body and it feels like uncomfortable because your reaction to it is not, you know, what it should be, breathe energy into it. And then you'll just tilt your head back up, force the breath out, release it. Breathe into it and then release. And that helps move energy. That helps prevent it from getting locked somewhere.
Right, right. And, you know, it is really beneficial for me. And obviously it depends on the type of person that you are and how you like to record activities and how you like to reflect on things that you've done. But I used to, not so much anymore, and I kind of kick myself in the ass over it now, but I used to write everything down. Like, as soon as I was done, as soon as I was finished casting, as soon as I knew that energy had been sent out and everything was kind of calmed down, I usually have a lot of excess energy left over anyway, even after it's done. So to stop being so twitchy and just, like, wanting to run around the house or, you know, ravish my man every time I cast a spell... that's, you know, that is a common side effect. Like we said, we're working with very sensual, sexual energies. And what I would do is write everything down. I would write everything, what I felt when, how I felt, everything I could possibly remember down. So if you have a traumatic experience, and it stops you from completing what you're doing, you know, write down and figure out that trigger. That way, if you can't, you know, just work through it, because, you know, we're all human, there's things that we can't work through sometimes right then, you know, to avoid that specific thing and work with it in smaller doses.
Right.
Until you can overcome it. So, and record it in any way you can. I mean, if you actually want to record yourself and just keep it for your own personal use, you know, I'm not saying record it, post it to YouTube or whatever, but, you know, so you know and can remember exactly what you've done or whatever, however is best for you. But, you know, it's important to... That's the whole point of Black Books and Book of Shadows and Grimoires. That's why we would write things down from the very beginning. So you understand what you've done afterwards. There's been many times that I've cast spells and been so into the moment, so caught up in the energy and the emotion, and afterwards I was just spent, and so I'd fall asleep, and then the next day I'm like, I don't even remember what the fuck I did.
Right.
You know, I just have to guess by all the shit that I left out, you know, on my altar or workspace, wherever I was, and guess because I was so caught up in that energy that it was just, I didn't write anything down, didn't remember shit, and I'm like, well, damn, that spell was really awesome. Why didn't I write this down?
Exactly.
So you might want to write down the ingredients at least beforehand. out of experience.
Or, you know, even it's because we have technology, fucking take a picture of it. Like, if you don't want to write it down, take a picture of it. Make sure you can identify it all. But, yeah, before I like to talk about formulas, but I'd want to get to this question first. And, y'all, if you have any questions about spell construction, if you need clarity on anything we've said, please use the Q&A, ask away, and we'll do our best to answer them. Someone said, witchcraft is a sensual and sexual thing. Oh, that explains so much. Light bulb just went on. Yes, honey, it did. But, okay, so I want to get to this. Randomness magic vlog. I need your name, honey. Like, I need... That's just a long... What's a long thing to say? The randomness magic vlog. I was wondering, I don't do malediction spells due to my own boundaries, but I would like to do some bindings against those that are spreading violence and hate against the LGBT plus community, or people, in order to keep it out of the hex or cross type. How would I do these? By the way, even though I myself don't cast malediction spells, I very much respect you guys and your wealth of knowledge. Thank you for all your videos you are doing. Aw, thank you. Well, because of that talk, the first thing that I would say is no binding, especially because you kind of the words contradict each other. Bind against. To me, binding is putting things together. And if you want against, like, you're trying, just go away. Like, just, ugh. You know? So, my name is random. I can do that. if, you know, a really good thing you can do is a few separate things. I wouldn't bind again because that, again, for me, my personal perception and experience with binding is you're not just binding the energies together, but you're also attaching it to yourself. You're invested into that working, so I wouldn't bind. You could banish. You could maybe start local, like if you know a situation, local, your community, whatever. You can banish things, like banish from maybe if you have a community center that is specifically for, you know, the LGBT community, you could put a banish, you know, like banish hate from it, do protection for it. You can even put spell bags, you know, around the area, or communicate with the spirits of the land in that area and form a relationship and boost that protection. I would definitely do like a banishing, so you can banish like negative influence. You banish. I don't like to banish hate per se because that's just so massive. It's big, and when you banish hate, there's so many intricate things that are not taken into consideration because people associate hate with so many different beliefs. So when you banish hate, it becomes an issue. At least from my experience and what I've witnessed. So I definitely banish like specific behavior and specific types of energy, and then I would do something to welcome welcome the type of energy you want in.
Right. And see, I don't know what your boundaries are, Random, so I'm not really sure, like, if you don't cast Malediction because you don't want to influence others, or, you know, what that is. But if it were me and I want to avoid the, influencing others aspect, you know, I would do an attraction spell for like good positive energy, you know, for the LGBT community, especially if, like Michael said, there's like an actual specific gathering place, you know, a gay bar or whatever, you know, you can do that, a park, you know, and with the park, you can really draw upon like a lot of elementals or natural energies there too. That would be amazing. In fact, you could plant trees or flowers or something of that effect into, if it was like a place that's outdoors or even has like an outdoor area where they won't like shoot you because you're trying to plant stuff, you know, people get picky about stuff like that, but you can infuse that plant with protection and to attract positive energy to, you know, if you don't want to like banish particular people because you don't want to influence them,
right,
to attract positive energy to a specific area. So you could definitely do that. It's like Michael said, protection is an awesome thing to do. Bindings, to me, whenever I think of bindings, I think of keeping something in one spot. If someone bound me to this chair, I wouldn't be able to move. So like Michael said, bindings aren't, because you don't want them to stay. You don't want to keep them in that space. And to me, bindings, that's what they do. I know that a lot of people see bindings in other ways, but to me, bindings are not exactly what people like to think they are. They're not like you see them portrayed. So those are the kind of energies I'd work with instead. You know, bringing, attracting positive energies, attracting healing, you know, healing energies. You know those cool little fountain that just plug into the wall? They're sort of small that roll the water around.
Mm-hmm.
You can use that to attract healing. It builds up its own energy, and if you add a couple of little oils in there, that would be awesome. If it's like a community space where they don't mind if you like, you know, bring something that would just add beauty to the area. A lot of places really don't mind. In fact, they love stuff like that.
The only thing I can think of, like, when a binding, if you want to even mess with that, would be to take a binding, like, bind, create that spell, and for that specific type of person, that specific type of energy, that hateful, that target, you know, that community, and send it to the dump. And that's one of my favorite things that I like to do. Because if you create something and you bind it, those energies are stuck together. Do not bind it to a locate, like your specific space. You want to bind it to like an object maybe, and then send it to the dump. Make sure it goes to the dump. Like you probably, if you can take it to the dump yourself, I would do that, because then it's going to stay in a shitty area. It's going to stay there where people throw their trash, where that specific influence is like, this is dirty shit, this is garbage, nothing belongs here but trash. And that's exactly what, for people who hate that type of hatred and stuff, like that's where it belongs, and the trash does not belong with us. So that's the only time I could see a binding possibly being utilized for such a thing. Another good thing you can do is create like an oil recipe. And if you don't have a specific, you know, LGBT community center, go to prominent places in your community, take that oil, and find some wood and work it into the wood in the prominent places in your community. So you can go to, like, doctor's offices, you can go to the courthouse, go to, you know, police stations, hospitals,
malls, movie theaters.
Exactly. And even just like very churches, you know, you want to go to very influential places in that community where you can work in your magic, where you can plant that seed of growth and have it take root. That would be perfect for creating healing and spreading your essence, spreading your power, your magic throughout the community. And if you wanted to get other practitioners in your community together to do that, you don't have to like create a public event, but just communicate with them personally and create like a formulation, create a powder, create something, come together, and then they can tackle different areas, outside areas, and that'd be a great thing for anyone to do.
Definitely. I'm here talking and I'm muted myself. yeah, that would be awesome, you know, and there's just so many different ways that you can incorporate very passive-aggressive spells that don't necessarily hurt or don't necessarily influence other people, but make the environment a lot more receptive, welcoming, and positive. So you just have to kind of think outside the box when it comes to stuff like that. And, you know, you can make a powder and cast it in parking lots, predominant places, and just, yeah, like Michael has there, you know, and cast it about, and it will be, you know, something. Just keep your idea or your goal in mind that you want something positive to come out of that. You want to attract positive energy with specific, I would be very specific in ways like acceptance of differences, you know, loving each other, brotherly love, sisterly love, that kind of thing. So, but that's definitely, there's the possibilities are truly endless. You can come up with a lot of different
things. It's fucking hot, y'all.
It truly is. I'm like dying in here.
Damn. Again, if y'all have any questions about the spell construction, obviously it's going to be personal to each and every one of you. It's very important for you to understand the way you cast and how your energy is experienced and the results you want, how you go about it, how we express, you know, each and every one of us, how our personal way of doing things. You take that into consideration, and then you act on the different types of the correspondences. Putting together what I'd like to briefly talk about is formulas, which is, you know, my favorite is essential oil blends or oil blends. Also, like herbal blends, as you can see right there, I'd be mixing up a lot of shit. It's, I love it. Like, creating formulas is one of my passions. I enjoy utilizing it because you can cast spells into your formulas. You can cast upon the stuff that you create and you activate it, and then other people can take that and utilize it to benefit themselves. When you're creating, let's say, an oil, give anyone want to suggest, like, what do you want to create an oil for? Like, just
create an oil to open the psychic senses to channel the tarot or oracle.
Huh. Okay, so I would start. I do a lot of dry and wet ingredients. So sometimes it's the oils that call to me first, and sometimes it's the herbs and the other things. So with Wet Hunter Express, we're gonna create an oil to open the psychic senses to connect with divination, to connect with the tarot and oracle cards. So the first thing that stood out was Dittany. And Dittany of Crete is very fuzzy. It's so nice. It smells wonderful. I love Dittany. And Dittany is really great to connect with channeling. It helps to helps the medium. It allows you to connect with spirit, and specifically allows you to connect with the dead. And it helps with transition. So Dittany of Crete is really good to add to your blend to communicate. And that, and when you smell it, it kind of just like opens that sense. It's nice. And so I would definitely add Dittany of Crete to that. Another one of my favorites, do I have it? I do. Again, Black Obsidian, just because a lot of people who, you know, channel and a lot of people who connect psychically, they need to see. They need to see clearly. Black Obsidian allows us to do that. Black Obsidian allows us to connect with the psychic centers and to it allows us to penetrate really deep and go past like blockages, and that is important when we're reading the tarot, because sometimes when a client comes to us, they're resisting. So that Black Obsidian comes in and it makes sure that that shit's being cut away, cords are being cut, and you're just going to get that information. So Black Obsidian mixed with Dittany. I would even, and I know it would dissolve, but I would add some selenite, because selenite, Black Obsidian's more earthy. It's more underworld, it's more physical realm, it's more present now and abyss type energy. Selenite does exact opposite. It connects with the cosmic soul. It connects with the divinity. It connects with higher realms. And so selenite will come in and it will help you be the person to get information across in a manner that is going to be for the highest and best of everyone. It's going to be very, it's going to promote great communication. And it connects with like the third eye, the crown chakra, and the higher chakras. So it brings the higher information, and it allows you to relay it. So Black Obsidian, Selenite, Dittany, and Black Tourmaline Powder. I've been using a lot of crystals for this. Black Tourmaline helps to like neutralize and ground that information, the psychic information, into the body, into the mind. It helps you to take that and root it so you can express it. And so that would be my dry blend. For that, I would utilize essential oils now. I would utilize bay essential oil. Bay is really good with psychic expression and connecting. Bay essential oil, I would utilize like blue lotus extract. Blue lotus is pricey as fuck, but it works wonderful. Blue lotus is great to really connect and to really like stimulate almost like that balance between trance and psychic and present moment. And because I'm talking a lot, I'm sorry y'all. Shit. Yarrow. That's yarrow. That's yarrow. Yarrow essential oil. Add that there. And then, yeah, so blue lotus, yarrow, bay, maybe a drop of, like, orange. Maybe. And then my carrier oil. And that's very simple. The simple. But I would also add, for me personally, would be Datura. And, yeah, I would add Datura to my formulation. But that's me. And utilizing that would help you to connect with the cards. It helps you connect with your psychic senses. It helps you to reach out. It helps you to penetrate the cosmic experience. It helps you to step into the cards because it's balancing the cosmic and the abyss, the underworld, the physical expression. It brings it into the present moment and it stimulates your psychic centers. So that is how I would create an oil formulation. Y'all, if you notice, that's just like what, bam, it came, was in my head. And I listen. When I'm creating oil, I listen. And I smell. I always sniff.
If you got nothing out of that, there you go. A free formula that in a lot of places would have been $5, if not more.
So true. You know, for me, when creating oils or formulas or scrubs or anything that I create, if I don't have a specific goal or in mind, I just want to create something new, and I want y'all to give your little opinion, y'all's opinions on this too, because I know both of y'all have done things like this. Whenever I create just something new, I just want, I'm in the mood to create. I personally like to just sort of do the whole blind, you know, close my eyes and grab something out of my, you know, cupboard of witchy fun stuff. So I'll grab something, and if it winds up being an oil, then I will base it around that oil. Let's, you know, if I grab orange oil, then I will base it around that. And I do a lot like Michael does. I like to smell. I like to smell the different oils and take, you know, scent is, aromatherapy is very essential. If it doesn't smell good, then chances are no one's going to like it, even though some things just don't smell good. So
you can't help. Some things, no.
Yeah, and especially, well, and not always just with malediction. I mean, malediction usually does smell pretty rank.
I think my malediction shit smell good, though. Like, that's one thing that you can't always avoid it, but my malediction, I try to make it smell like you want it, like candy. Right.
Yeah, and that does help, but man, some stuff you use, you just can't hide some of that shit.
That is so true.
And you know what else tends to smell kind of ugh to me is there's a lot of prosperity smells that really kind of smell rank.
They do. They stain.
I used rabbit shit the last time I cast a prosperity smell.
So whenever y'all are just creating to create and you don't have a goal in mind, what do you rely totally, because I know I rely totally on instinct and just start grabbing stuff and see what happens.
I sit there and I have like conversations with my I am not down with the crystals as much as I am the herbs and the roots. Herbs for me are a little bit more milder energies, where the tops of herbs and the stems of herbs and the flowers of herbs, rather than roots. Roots are really, really loud, and they're very, very talkative, and roots tend to think that they want to be in everything, and I have to say, hey, listen, it's okay. You don't have to be in all of this. Sometimes they're necessary, and sometimes they talk me into it. So honestly, when I'm just creating to create, because
resins are the same way. Resins are super loud.
Resins are very loud. But you know, this is my theory behind that. There's so much, like, a root is so, like, it's the base of everything. Like, the root is where the nutrients ebb and flow. So they are the loudest. They're the most essential part next to the flower, well, next to the leaves and the stem, which transfers. But all the nutrients that comes from the ground comes from the root, and I think that makes them very loud and very outspoken, as opposed to a resin.
Resins are pretty loud too, because resins are like the blood of a plant.
Exactly, that's where I was going with that. Yeah, they're like essential oils. Essential oils are very loud because they are like
crazy.
Yeah, well, they are the essence. They're crazy, legit. So yeah, well,
they're concentrated.
Right.
They're concentrated herb. So to me, they will have, some of them will have completely different personalities. Like dried orange peel and orange oil, to me, are very, very similar. They're not they're not as different. But if you take something like jasmine flowers versus the jasmine, completely different energy. That's just
completely for sure.
Yeah, it is way
more potent. It's like, well, and like bergamot. Oh my god! Like, if you actually had like bergamot peel, it is. I don't like its. This is just me. I don't like its energy. Essential oils of bergamot, I love.
It's wonderful.
It is wonderful. I don't care for the peel, but when it's all together and it's been concentrated in that form, you get the true essence of it, and I love it.
Yeah. It's wonderful. It really is. It is just swell. When I'm creating something just to create, it's not just to create, when I have that, it's more of like that itch, like it's that call, that inspiration, but I don't know what I want to create, but I know that I have to create something. And so I kind of trance out, like I will separate myself from my body. And I'll just go. And what I do is, like, I'll just, like, I don't even know. Like, I'm not in my body. I'm out. And so I will go and I will touch, like, different herbs and I will listen to what expresses itself. I will lay my shit out. I will go to a crystal if it needs to be there. I will start to gather things and I'll place it. And I'm, like, I touch it and, you know, I place my hand over it or I communicate, connect with it. I'm, like, what do I need? What do I need? Okay, cute. And I don't allow for time to go too long on something. I'll just be like, okay, what do I need? Okay, I need this. Okay, let's go with this. Okay. And then I'll snap out of it once it's all done. And I'm like, well, now I gotta do some research. What is this good for? You know? And I'm like, okay, I know what they're saying it's good for, but then I like to attach like the mundane properties of the essential oils and the herbs to it and have a deeper understanding. So when I'm called to create something, I trance. I let go and I allow information to process.
Yeah, and for like okay, for all of those that actually have either been privy our members been privy to our formularies, or if you have bought our formularies, this is just an example of that, because a lot of times
right.
Our formularies can be so fucking broad. Where, like, the witch's necessity formula, the goal in mind was things that you thought were essential to the witch. That was what we talked about. That's what a lot of those, there were a couple of the ones that I created that I use and are very true and dear to my heart. A lot of them, I did not give my personal formulas. I gave formulas that spirit led me to create for that formulary. And there's a very different, so I had a goal in my mind of maybe, okay, prosperity, for example. My prosperity formula in that, that's not necessarily a prosperity formula that I use for my personal practice. That was specific for the formulary, and that's what Spirit said, this is what it's, this, you want to talk necessity, this is necessity. This is what I need you to do. So that was my goal in mind. So then I go into like this, I don't know if it's a trance so much as it is a shift of consciousness.
Yeah.
Not outside. It's like a shift in consciousness where I am communicating fully with my curios, my herbs, my roots, my random ingredients of a random MacGyver type, because that happens a lot. And then I go, okay, this is my goal. And then I am almost led, and it's like they're raising their hands, like, motherfucker, like, this is, you need me. And then I know that sounds completely fucking bonkers, but that is true. It's a true story. And no, that's how I create a lot of my formulary.
Well,
yeah, that's just the way it is when you work with stuff like that.
When you're, you know, it's just like a beacon. Like, you know, when you need something, there's a beacon of light and you notice it more. Leilokin, do you add anything to your essential oils or use them as is, for example, protection or divination? I'm not quite sure if I'm totally getting it, so if I do not answer your question correctly, just inform me and I'll do my best to respond. I add, like, with my essential oils, when I create a formula, I do add different essential oils. I create it. I'll add, like, crystal chips or herbs and the carrier oil for sure. And then I'll activate it. And that's kind of, like, what I was going to transition into. is activating your work is super important. Activating your formulas sets you apart from everyone else, because no matter what, at the end of the day, you are not going to be able to do what I can do. You can do what you can do. You can activate what you can activate. And it's not I'm better, you're better. It's nothing like that. It's just we all have our own energy, our own personal way of doing things. And so we might have the same formula, but we're going to totally activate it differently. We're going to put something different into it. And so you have to find your way. When I activate like a psychic formula, I might include different crystals on a grid. Okay, so yeah, it was like carrier. I do utilize carrier oils. Most of the time, it just depends on what I'm doing. If I'm doing like a malediction oil, a lot of the times I'll use castor oil. When I'm doing like a love working or love oil, I might use like cherry kernel oil, avocado oil. I might sweet almond. It just depends, really.
For me, each carrier oil has specific properties in itself. So, right. Like, if I'm doing a blessing, I like to use olive oil because I feel like that is more suitable to blessings. Olives, you know, have often represented peace, blessings, you know, that kind of harmony. So whenever I use carrier oils, which, I mean, most essential oils, you have to use carrier oils anyway. You can't, because I like to apply them on several things, including my skin.
Right.
So it's just safer that way. But each carrier oil to me has very specific energies of themselves. So I know, like, for me, like Michael said, I'll base it on what I'm doing. I use coconut oil a lot in things that are going to pamper or a kind of luxurious working, where it's more about what you want, not what you need, you know, because
right.
Coconut oil is very pampering. So, yeah, exactly.
That looks gross, but this is my oil that I created. It's called the Dreadful Mystic. I wonder where I got my inspiration from. But if you can see, it has two oils. There's aloe vera in here, and there is aloe vera. There's a little bit of like walnut, and then sweet almond.
That's funny, because we all practice differently. Like, a lot of my maledictive oils, I use olive oil for. So, whereas you use olive oil for blessing, I normally use it because olive oil is so pungent and so hardcore. Like, it just is, especially the more potent the oil, the more potent the working. So, like,
well, it also depends on how the oil is made, too, like how it's pressed or refined.
Right. Cold press is very differently than, like, you know, it all depends on the work. It just depends, and of course it depends on the practitioner. It's just like castor oil. I would never use castor oil for a benedictive oil. I just wouldn't. Castor oil for me is suited for malediction.
Different practices. Until recently, I would have only used castor in malediction and that work. But something just clicked the other day, because castor oil is really, it has some really great benefits, like on a mundane level. So
there's very few oils of the base oil variety, like the carrier oils, that don't have very benefit. I mean, obviously, olive oil and sweet almond oil and castor oil and jojoba oil, like all of it is palm kernel oil. All of it is very beneficial one way or another to us. So, and to animals. So, I mean, I agree with that, but yes, castor oil. When I think castor oil, this is how I work. When I think castor oil, I think of my grandma. I also think of their use of castor oil in the 1950s and 60s. And then I want to vomit because they honestly believe that castor oil was like that end-all, be-all medicine of that time period, and it makes me the misinformation of that time period and the fact that they used it for a lot just makes me want to vomit. So obviously, I think I associate that with vomit, malediction. Like that's how.
But sometimes you need to purge in order to get better. So we can go.
Let's disagree. Michael's gonna be the annoying person that's gonna be like, well, I think I would, but like for me, like sweet almond, I would never ever use sweet almond for malediction because it just does not have that energy. Michael's gonna be like, oh, I don't know, because worked properly, it can sweeten that shit, and make people walk into their own malediction.
Well, like, honey,
too many almonds can literally like make you deathly ill.
Right.
So I can see it. You mean you should
too many apples can make you, everything can make you deathly ill.
Well, that's true, but almonds have, you know, they have that arsenic base, right? Well, isn't it almonds?
So do peaches.
Okay, y'all. So
apples.
So you can see how the process goes. Like
every
witch is going to have their personal perception, and every witch is going to have what they honor and what they feel is true and blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. So and that's important. You can see how we could debate about this all day, and it'd be interesting. But again, we got to close this up, y'all, because we're talking for days. But if you have any questions, please feel free to utilize the Q&A, ask questions. We'll try to answer as many as we can before we go. But the very important step in creating formulas, oils, herbal blends, is the activation process. That's charging your work. Whether you create a crystal grid, whether you charge it by the sun, the moon, the stars, the Holy Ghost, I don't know. You go to
the life into it.
Mm-hmm.
Holy
shit.
Ghost can be a motherfucker.
I'm just saying. But, you know, and you should be, when you're creating something, you should be charging it as you go. And I do. There's, for my, this is my Deviant Wall of Protection formulation, my herbal blend, which I also have new, an oil. It smells wonderful. Fuck, I'm happy with that shit. But as I create and I grind the herbs in this motherfucker right here, well, mostly, I chant, I pour energy, I channel energy. It's just not, I don't do personal energy, a little bit, yeah, but I call in ancestors and spirits and other energies and entities and beings, and so as I am creating and working the formula, I have a specific chant that I do for this. And it adds protection, it adds a blessing, it empowers, it strengthens. And there's also a flare of deviance, mean. Like, just, you know, you fuck with me, you're going to get hurt. And so anyone who works with this blend, it protects them. It will protect. It'll be very submissive, but at the same time, something's trying to come and get it, it's going to attack and it's probably going to rip your fucking throat out.
It's like 7/8 protection, 1/8 bitch. Like,
exactly. Like me. I won't deny that shit. But it's true. Like, activation is vital.
Mm-hmm. It is. I agree. That is that. I mean, if you don't have activation, then you don't. Even when you build up energy, if you haven't activated whatever it is you're working with, you're building all that energy up for nothing. Because it's not going to do anything if it doesn't have a life of its own. Yeah. You know, I tend to think of all spell work, regardless of what kind it is, a lot like puppets or servitors or anything like that. You want it to have a certain life of its own. Well, you want to bring it to life. Otherwise, it's just a bunch of herbs in a pot or bowl.
It's just some shit floating around in a vial.
Yes.
And you can, and you know, y'all, like, when you receive something, you feel it. Like, you can tap into it. And that's, and that's also how people who aren't so skilled can cast and create, because there's other people who create, you know, okay, so there's other people who create powerful tools and ingredients, and people can take advantage, you know, take that and make it work for them because they have these power, these powerful things put together, and they can cast using that, and that's pretty cool for people who aren't as skilled or maybe don't have. That sounds so mean, but I don't mean it to be. But they don't have what it takes to do for themselves. Maybe they're not a witch.
No, I don't. That's so rude and so mean because there are several things that look. There are people that sing that still listen to other people's music. So that is not necessarily the case. I use a lot of your oils, and
no, that's not what I was meaning.
I know that. It doesn't mean that. I know what you meant, but the way you expressed it was very different. So what I'm trying to say is that sometimes people do it better. It's not necessarily that you can't do it, and well, there are obviously things that you do better that maybe that other witch can't. But there are some things that are just done well. And then there are other times that, honest to God, and this is just me, I'm too fucking lazy to do it if I have an oil that can.
Well, and
why do I want to fuck with what is already created and perfect?
That's not like, what I was saying.
No, that's well, that's the way.
I don't even know what Hunter's talking about because I mean, I know what
he's trying to make me look like a bitch. No,
which is that create stuff. So other witches don't have to witch. Like, that's...
No.
But Michael has always said, if you can't do it, there are somebody that can, and you can buy from them, and it's not a big deal. Like, that is... It's okay not to be able to do it. I can't make candles from shit. I buy my candles. It's okay.
Okay, so, yes. Yeah. You're absolutely correct, exactly. And, you know, why would you make something for yourself if you just don't have passion for it? Like, someone else has a passion and they desire it and they love doing it. So I would rather support, like, tea. I do not make my own teas. Like, there is the Third Eye Tea, Visionary Tea that you make that I love that I'm not going to make myself. Like, just
well,
no.
Like, you just don't, everyone perceives energy different. Like, I hate making oils. I despise it. Very few times. Is Melissa frozen, or is she
still? No, she's not frozen. Anyways, so yeah, someone, we gotta go.
I'm reading over here, these comments, that's all.
Yeah, we gotta go soon, y'all, but what are your thoughts on mushrooms?
I don't know. They taste good if they're edible, and the ones that get you high taste like shit.
Are you talking about
pot? I don't know. Well, mushrooms are very phallic, and they're very wonderful. Who doesn't like Alec.
I'm confused at what. Well, some people don't like on.
Anyway, people like, I don't know.
People like their own phallus, but not everyone else's phallus.
They're really great for like. You can use them in a lot of aphrodisiacs, spice up your sex life, kind of thing. If your partner likes mushrooms, if they don't like mushrooms, I wouldn't do it. And that's well, just the regular edible ones. You know.
Fertility.
Fertility. Mm-hmm.
Fairy magic.
Definitely.
What kind of mushrooms are we talking about?
We don't know.
We're just going to go with edibles. Like, they're like Korean.
Are you talking Kermini? Are you talking Chanterelle?
Oh my gosh. Okay.
Oh my gosh, no. We're talking about, I like portobellos personally.
Can't say mushrooms.
Because they're really tasty. Different. But okay. Yes, each mushroom is different.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're being generic, Hunter.
Just go play with your mushrooms and find out. So yes, Layla, and I don't know how to witch. I just played one on YouTube. I hear you. Me too.
Amy says, "Great as always. I'm growing so much because of all of you. Thanks. You're so welcome, Amy. Thank you for watching."
Amy is that?
Amy Leslie.
Amy Bell.
It doesn't matter what Amy. I love all the Amys.
So, y'all, Thank you for being a part of this experience. It's been fun. I hope you enjoyed it. If you watch this, if you're watching the recording, if you have any questions, utilize the comments. And comment on the YouTube video and ask us, and we check that often. I check it often. And, you know, we'll respond and we'll do our best. Invite your friends to join the Deviant Witchery experience. We love interaction. We love when you guys share with us because it's just fun. It's fun to, you know, to feed off of each other and just to go, you know, and just share and bounce ideas off and connect and grow. That's what I find. And then you just have no idea what people are going to say. People are going to say live or do live. You just don't know. It's a fun adventure. Definitely check out the page. We have a lot of stuff that's going on there. We also have a new, like, a seller group, like a magical bazaar, where, you know, Melissa, the Sassy Witch's Cauldron, and I, right now at the moment, we have our businesses and we're selling stuff. We love creating. And ever so often, we have a day where all of you, if you create handmade magical goods, you can post yours and you can sell and you can be a part of that. So definitely check that out. I'll post that in the description. Share the video. Have fun. And if you have anything that you would love to see us talk about, don't hesitate to let us know. Peace, y'all.